few more things to talk about forms. Then we'll go from there. All right. Checkboxes. I think checkboxes were the one thing that I did not demonstrate, either in my own example or by going to W3 Schools. Let's see if W3 Schools has an example of this. If not, we can go to, we can make one. By the way, here's a good tip for Googling. If you're looking for something on a specific website, if you type site colon and then the name of the site, it will search only that site. So for example, I'm looking for checkbox. If I do that, it will search the whole internet. But if I do checkbox site colon and put the address of the site, then it will search only on that site. So if you happen to be on a site and they don't have a search box, which some sites don't have a search box, or if you're on one and the search results turn out funky, because sometimes a site won't have a good search facility, you can always do that. All right, and there are some issues that I don't really want to get into, but this will solve your problem a lot of the time. So let's go in here and try a checkbox. All right, here we go. Good, they have an example. Not that I don't feel like writing the code, but if they have the example out there, then you can refer to this just as well. All right, input type equals checkbox. Notice a couple things compared with a drop-down. Radio buttons. First of all, physically they look square instead of round. So that's one thing. The other thing is, even though they have the same name, which I wouldn't do, by the way, all right, but that's another story. Even though they have the same name, they are not mutually exclusive. So I can check one or the other or both. All right. So that's how you do a checkbox. Oftentimes, checkboxes are used for, like, yes or no questions. All right. In other words, I have a bike. Yes, I do. No, I don't. All right. I've read the privacy and policy statement, and I agree to the terms and conditions. Check that. Yes or no. All right. I want to join the mailing list. Yes or no. All right. So, if you have a yes or no question, there's actually probably three ways that you could do it that would be reasonable. You could have a single checkbox that said the yes or no question. Let's say join mailing list. You could have a single checkbox for yeah, check it to join the mailing list, don't check it, and you won't join the mailing list. You could have a radio button, join the mailing list, yes, no, or you could have a drop down with the yes or no. Any of those are fine. There's reasons why that you would want to do one versus the other. And a lot of it has to do with, you know, if you want to match the way that your form looks. You know, if you had a whole bunch of radio buttons on your form, you know, you might want to make that a radio button too, just to get sort of a consistent look. Or if you have a bunch of drop downs or whatever. So you have some flexibility on how to do things. One thing that you would not want to do, though, is use a text box, because you don't know what you're getting from a text box. All right, with a checkbox or a drop-down or a radio button, you control what gets sent to the server. Now, in the case, what gets sent to the server here is the word bike and the word car. All right. You could also make it yes or no, yes bike, or whatever, you know. And you would match whatever the server is expecting. Any questions on this? Everything that we've talked about so far falls under the category of basic form controls. That is, form controls that have been part of HTML for ages. All right. What we're going to talk about now are some of the things that were added in HTML5. Now, we used the term graceful degradation before. All right. And I want to make sure it's clear what that means, because these tags degrade gracefully. And that's kind of a weird statement to make, and I want to make sure that we understand what that means. Degrade gracefully means that, specifically when we're talking about HTML5 tags, it means if you view them on a browser that doesn't support HTML, will it still work? Will it still at least sort of work, right? Because if the browser doesn't understand HTML, it's not going to work as well as it would on a browser that does understand HTML5. All right? But is it going to break the page? And the answer is no, it won't break the page. All these HTML5 controls that we're talking about will end up like a plain old text box if the browser doesn't support HTML5. So I'll demonstrate that as we go in and look for HTML5 form controls. HTML5 form elements. All right. The input, the select, and all that stay the same. There is a data list, which is like a drop-down, and there is a key gen field and so on, but what I want to look at is the different input controls, the different input text boxes. And let me find where those examples are. I do apologize if things take me a little bit longer today. I am wearing old glasses, as you might have noticed. And these are not bifocals like my other glasses were. And it's really weird because it looks like I'm walking downhill as I walk. So if I take a spill on the way to lab today, you'll know that's the reason why. Plus, I have to like look like an old school librarian by putting my glasses on the end of my nose when I'm trying to read closer. And I push them back when I'm trying to read further away. I know it's not really important. You don't really need to know that, but I figured it was worth mentioning. All right, where is the HTML5 stuff at? Here's what I'm looking for. All right, here's a new type, new HTML type, an input type for color. All right, and that's pretty cool, right? You might use this if you're allowing users to customize their page. You know, you could customize a page to give a different background color and foreground color. And that's nice to do just because, you know, it's nice to let people, you know, view the page the way they want to. They can personalize it, make it feel their own, make feel a little more comfortable with it. But this also has accessibility options, right? Because if you have certain vision problems, certain color schemes may work better for you than others. All right, so it's good to be able to sort of customize the look of the page. So if I click this, all right, select your favorite color, and I get this little thing, and it assumes my favorite color is red. I don't know why it assumes that, but it does. If I click this, though, it gives me this little grid that I can go, and I can pick what I want, like a darker green, a lighter green. I can sort of pick the color I want. Maybe I don't like red. Maybe I like this shade of green. So I could pick that and click OK, and it changed to that shade of green. All right? So it's a color picker. And depending on the system that you're on, the color picker will look a little bit different. So if you're on a Mac versus a PC, it would look different. And this is a different input type, and it was not supported prior to HTML5 at all. Now, we happen to be using Google Chrome, and Google Chrome has very good HTML5 support. If we look at Internet Explorer, I bet it's not going to end up so good. So if we view this page in Internet Explorer, ta-da, notice what we get. We get a plain old text box. This is what is known as degrading gracefully. What does that mean, degrade? It means less functionality. So if you're on an old browser that doesn't support HTML5, it doesn't break your form. It just gives you a text box instead. All right? And that's kind of confusing for a user that have to know what the HTML codes are, or maybe they'd have to type red, or maybe they could give a shot at typing red or green or whatever. All right? But at the very least, it doesn't break your form. All right? What you should do in this case is have validation, either on the client side or on the server side, to make sure that the user enters in a proper value for color. So, unfortunately, you can't assume now that that browsers are going to support all HTML5 form controls. So you have to, if you use them, it doesn't mean don't use them. It just means be aware of it. And if you use any of these HTML5 controls, you may have to write something on JavaScript or on the server side to validate and make sure they've entered a valid value. Let's check the Edge browser as well. I think the same thing is true with Edge. And it is. So neither of the two Microsoft browsers support, at least the versions that we have installed on this machine. That could have been corrected. Now remember, there is a good site, we talked about this before, that you can use, I think it's called May I Use, that shows, or Can I Use? I don't know, May I Use sounds more proper, right? Can I Use sounds like, yeah, you can use it, might not work, but... You know, so I'd have called it May I Use, but I don't know. All right, so I can type in, for example, input, and it'll tell me that color type input. According to this, Edge 14 and 15 support it, so we must have an earlier version of Edge. But IE 11 does not support it. Safari up to 10.1, if you're on a Mac, doesn't support it. iOS Safari, so if you're on an iPhone, it doesn't support it. And if you're using the Opera Mini browser, it doesn't support it. So this is good information to know, right? Because it'll at least give you an idea of... the percentages of people that use that browser, and you can make a decision then if it's worth using or if it's not worth using. According to this, if I'm understanding this number right, 77% of the people are using browsers that support that. So, 3/4 of the people are using that. But still, do you want your website broken for 1/4 of the people? No. So therefore, fortunately, it just simply turns into a text box if the browser doesn't support the color type. And then you could go in and put JavaScript code or server-side validation to make sure that they have put in a valid color. So that's sort of the good news about all of these. And we'll see that with the other HTML5 types as well. There's a date control. Prior to HTML5, a text box was a text box, just that. A box that you could put any text that you wanted in. All right? And it did not differentiate, and you could not specify the kind of data that was going to be in it. So prior to HTML5, you had to write JavaScript validation. Well, unfortunately for us, even now with HTML5, you probably still have to write JavaScript validation because there are approximately, at least for the color control, approximately 1/4 of the people that are using browsers that don't support HTML5. So, let's check what the date input. It's about the same, a little more. The sort of, I don't know what you call that, olive green or lighter green means it sort of supports it. All right? So, it gives you a little more detail about that, partial support, and so on. So with this, you can, and no versions of Firefox support the date. It's weird. I know. I didn't make these rules, right? Or I didn't write these browsers, so don't ask me to explain why it is. But, you know, about 80%. So, again, that's still a solid 1/5 of your users. The date control is not going to work if you have a typical website. So does that mean that, you don't use the date control? No, you still use it because that will make life easier for those 80% of the people that can. Their browsers can understand the date control, but you're still going to have to put in JavaScript or server-side validation to check for a valid date. All right. So, what does the date control look like? Well, gives me a birth date, a month, day, year. If I click that, I get the calendar control, so I can pick a date. And what's more, I can enter in something goofy. So let me try to enter in April 99th. I can't enter in April 99th. I can't even enter April 32. I typed 32, it changed it to April 31. Which, by the way, is still not right, right? There ain't no April 31st, is there? No. There's only 30 days in April. So, a little bug in that. But at any rate, this makes it a little more, a little easier. And I can go up the year, I can go down the day, and so on. So you can use these controls if you have a date, or if you have a color, or if you have some of the other fields that we're going to talk about. Just be aware that not all browsers are going to support them. So we've seen color, we've seen date. All of these are simply specialized version of the old school text box. What's the next one on our list? Oh, you can add restrictions to the date. I think this is something that it said that the iPhone doesn't support. So, for example, you can put in a birth date, and it has to be before. The first date has to be before January 1st, 1980. This one has to be after July 1st, 2000. What if I try to enter in a date? If I try to enter that, boom, I get an error message. Now, in the old days, you would have had to have done that with JavaScript. All right, but the the nice thing of the HTML5 is it takes care of that for you. Again, the downside is, unfortunately, the way that these standards are developed and the way that browsers are written, not all browsers support the same features at the same time. So you have to sort of live with the fact that you can use this control, but it's not going to work on some browsers exactly the same way. Fortunately for us, it gracefully degrades, which means you'll still get a text box. If I go and view this in Edge, I still get a text box. Oh, it works in Edge. Yay. I get a different date picker. Let's try it in Internet Explorer. Doesn't. It's just a plain old text box. So I could type in anything. And server says, yep, that's the dates that you put in. Doesn't know that those are not valid dates. So therefore, you would have to put some validation code in your program. Again, we're not covering how to do that. We might touch on that when we get to JavaScript. But that's how it was in pre-HTML5. Let's see what else we have in HTML5. Date, time, local. That's where you can type in a date and a time. So I could type in that something is due 11:11 a.m. Email address. So if I put in something that doesn't match the format of an email address, it gives me an error. I have to type something in that matches the format of an email address. So mzellers@lorainecc.edu. All right, that did work. There's a control for month. There's a control for number. And you can put a minimum and maximum. So I can't type in, or if I try to type in 58, it tells me it has to be less than or equal to 5. A range gives me this thing that I can slide this. Now, there's a little problem with this is it doesn't tell you the value. So, for example, if you said, you know, what would be an example you could do this for? Rate someone on a scale of 1 to 10 or 0 to 10, this does. If we look at this, is that a 6 or is that a 7? I don't know. All right. And that's one sort of drawback to that. If I click on submit, it tells me, oh, that was 7. You could actually write some JavaScript to make a little label display the value of it, so, and that would be a good thing to do. A search. Not sure what that does for me. Just looks like a regular text box. Telephone number, time, URL, week, and that's about it. So my suggestion is use these when you can, because a good percentage of the people will get the advantage of having the HTML5 control if you have one of these specialized things. But do know, as you go forward, that if you use them, there's still a significant portion of the population, quarter to a fifth approximately, whose browsers don't support those features, and therefore you'll need to take other means to make sure that they enter valid data, namely either JavaScript validation or server-side validation. Any questions about this? Did I show you the W3C.org validators? Yes? No? Maybe?
I don't think so.
Okay. The fact that none of us can remember probably means that if I did do it, I probably should do it again. All right? We talk about browser compatibility, right? And nothing beats testing your code on different browsers. As we saw, browser compatibility can sneak in any number of places. There can be browser compatibility with JavaScript, which we haven't talked about yet, with CSS, with HTML, with HTML5 features, and so on. One thing that can trigger browser compatibility issues is if you don't follow the rules of HTML, right? Because if you follow the rules of HTML, in theory, your page should look the same across all browsers, or very similar. Unfortunately, that's not the case. You still have to test it, but it's a really good starting point. The idea is if you break the rules of HTML, the browser doesn't really know for sure what to do, and it guesses at it. So how do you check your page to make sure it meets the rules of HTML? Well, essentially what you need is you need like a grammar checker, like the grammar checker that's in Word, but you need it for HTML, right? The grammar checker in Word, if I type in a sentence that isn't correct, it will tell me that it's not correct, all right? The validators on W3C.org tell me if my code is not correct. So let me go and let me download an example that we did sometime in the past. So let me download the example that we covered last time. Download I gotta download the form example. I'm gonna download the prototype that I did a few classes back. So this is a prototype that I did a few weeks back. So I have several of them out there, right? Let's look at the first one. If you remember, this is what the page looked like. All right. That's what the page looked like. So how do I know the code is valid? All right. Well, could stare at it. Yeah, I think it follows all the rules that we said it should. But how good is your staring at it? You know, it's like typing a term paper. Are you going to spot all your grammar and spelling errors simply by staring at it longer? Probably not. That's why it's good to have some automated things. So let me go to W3C.org. This is the website of the people that are responsible for defining the web standards, the World Wide Web Consortium. All right. So these are the folks that define what HTML should be. So they made up the rules for HTML5. They said HTML5 should do this. There should be these new tags. All right. And so on. So these are the people that literally wrote the book on HTML. Now if you notice on the side of the page, there is some validators. I'm going to look, first of all, validator. I can validate my code a couple of different ways. I can put in a URL. So I can type in www.loraineccc.edu or whatever. I can upload a file, or I can just paste my code in. And that's usually what I do. So let me go in here. Let me select everything from here, and let me paste it in here. And I collect check. And there's a couple results. It's going to tell me errors I have, it's going to tell me warnings that I have, and it's going to tell me things that I might want to check on, all right, that I don't necessarily have to do, but it might be a good idea to check. So let me click check, and let's see what it gives me. Document checked complete. No errors or warnings to show. Wow, I am so good. I typed this in just off the top of my head and didn't make any errors. Well, that's good, right? Well, let's go and on purpose make an error. Now, I'm so good, I don't even know if I can make an error on purpose, but I'll try real hard. All right? Let me go in and let me... let me misspell header, so I put an extra R on header, all right, and I'll click check. Ah, gives me four errors, all right. That's an interesting thing. It gave me four errors. I only had one letter wrong. I had an extra R, yet it gave me four errors. Why is that? Well, because this is a machine that is looking at your code, all right? It's not going to have the judgment to say, hey, dummy, you typed in an extra R. It's going to just know where things break down. So let's look at the errors. And learning how to read the errors is a skill, right? It takes practice. So I would suggest from now on, validate your code and see what it says. So the first error says stray end tag. What do I mean by, what does it mean by a stray end tag? It means it has an end tag that doesn't have a start tag. So there is an end header with two R's tag, and there is not a start header. All right? So it says that that's an error. All right? Because there's an end tag that doesn't go with a start tag. All right? So that's one thing that it notices wrong. The next thing it notices wrong is it tells me that footer should not be a descendant of the header element. In other words, this is telling me that I have my footer inside my header. And besides sounding painful, you know that's not allowable. Can't have the footer inside the header. Why does it think the footer's inside the header? Because what I did was I got rid of the end header tag. So the header tag starts here. Where does the header tag end? Well, that isn't the end tag for it. That's a different tag in the validator's eye. So it makes it all the way down to the footer and says the footer inside the header has a penalty. So it throws a penalty flag on that one. All right. So that's the second error that it found. The third error that it found is it found the end body tag, but it didn't find the end header tag, right? So it hit the end body tag, and that header tag is still open. So it knows that that's wrong. Because the header tag started inside the body, it should end inside the body. So if it hit the end body tag, then something's wrong, all right? Something's wrong. And finally, it tells me that the start header tag doesn't have an end header associated with it. So, really, one thing that you do wrong can trigger a whole bunch of errors. All right. can trigger a whole bunch of errors. Here's the interesting thing. Let me go and mess this up. Let me go and make that change here and save it. Didn't really cause it to be that bad. It just shifted it a little bit. So, if your code doesn't look exactly the way that you think, one thing to do is double check to make sure you followed all the rules. How can you double check? Well, you can double check by running it through the validator. All right? And sometimes that will be enough to tell you what's wrong with your code. Like, if I was looking at this and I was saying, why is that shifted over? If I ran it through the validator, I'd see I did not have the end header tag correct. And I would know to correct that. So I go, oh, that's what I did wrong. I correct it. And there it's looking the way that I wanted it to. Now again, running it through the validator doesn't guarantee you have a good web page. Doesn't guarantee it's going to look the same across all browsers, but it's a good first step, right? Because where you violate the rules is where you're likely to have different browsers display the page different ways. All right? Not necessarily, but maybe. So the first step in getting cross-browser compatibility is making sure you follow the rules. If you follow the rules, then you still need to test, unfortunately, but at least you're starting from a point where you know there's nothing wrong with your code. Here's the dirty truth, sort of, all right, that it doesn't matter whose fault it is if your page doesn't look right. You may have done everything by the book and done everything correctly, but a particular browser might not display your page correctly. Guess what? It's still your problem to fix. Right? Even if the browser maker didn't do a good job and there's a bug in the browser, still your job to fix. All right? Now, there's a validator for CSS as well. So I can go back to W3C. And go to the CSS validator. I have the same options here. So I'm going to go and I'm going to paste my CSS code in here. And when I do that, I can type check, and congratulations, no errors found. Just too good. All right. Let's break it on purpose again, if I can. I'll try. Let me make the classic error. I've seen so many students do this, and even I've done this. You know, you're in a hurry, and you type background, and you forget the G. You make it background. All right. So I go and save that. Now let me go and view the page. Of course the page isn't going to work. Because the browser doesn't know what background is. The browser knows what background is. So you might be looking at your page and say, why doesn't that work? I set the background of the body to blue. Why isn't it blue? Alright. Again, you could stare at the page and try to figure out. Or you can use a systematic way. And so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to use a systematic way. I'm going to paste my code in now that I've made the error. And the validator should tell me what's wrong with it. Sorry, we found the following errors. Property background does not exist. Oh, that's right, I forgot the G in it. So I go and change this. Save it. repaste it. First of all, notice that my background color mysteriously works now. And then I'll go and run it through the validator to make sure I didn't create some other problem. And I'm back to no errors found. So these are good tools. They maximize your chances of having a browser compatibility issue. You know, that's why we have grammar rules, believe it or not. Why do we have grammar rules and spelling rules? To reduce the misunderstandings. All right? Because if you have a sentence that is, you know, incorrect grammar, it could confuse a person, and they might not know exactly what you mean, and they might end up doing something wrong. So use this as your first step in debugging. The other thing that I do in debugging CSS that doesn't relate to the validator is if my sections of my page aren't lining up correctly the way I would expect them to, I give each section a different background color, temporarily even. And, you know, I make them wildly different so that I can tell at a glance, like, oh, this section goes all the way over to here. I thought it was going to end here. And then I can see what I did wrong and adjust it. So I might make one section green, one section pink, the other section purple, and so on. So hopefully I'll remember to get rid of those colors before I publish the site. But I do that just as a way of telling. The other thing that you can do is you can put a border around stuff, because the border helps you see exactly where a section of your page is. So that's another good debugging tool. Any questions about this? I want to start the next topic, because there's a topic I want to talk about that I forgot about. But I want to talk about it because it's good to kind of close the loop. All right? You finish making a web page and a website on your machine. How do you make it available for the world to see? Has anyone ever done that? Has anyone ever published a website? What do you do to do that? What did you do, rather?
I purchased a hosting account from GoDaddy.
Okay.
And then I uploaded there, and then it just.
Okay. Good write-up. Let me review what was said. I think there was only maybe one thing missing, and maybe you counted it as part of purchasing the account.
The domain.
Register the domain. Right. Here in general are the steps to make your website go live. All right. And we'll talk about these more in detail, and maybe we'll upload just some silly file to my website just for the fun of it. Number one, you register the domain. Number two, you purchase a web server account with some web hosting company. And did you register the domain through GoDaddy?
I did.
Yeah, a lot of them sort of bundle these into one step to make them sort of your one-stop shop. That simplifies things a lot. You could do it as separate steps, but a lot of times people will do that just in one step. In other words, if you go and purchase a hosting account at GoDaddy, part of the service they'll provide is they'll register your domain. And then you upload your files. Now, sometimes that can be done through like a control panel web page. And then the other alternative is you can use what's called an FTP program. FTP stands for File Transfer Protocol. What's a domain? What do you mean by a domain? What do I mean by a domain?
The address to your site.
The address to your site. And it's like the first part of the address to your site. So like, what is Lyon Community College's domain?
LorraineCCC.edu.
Yeah, LorraineCCC.edu. Or www.lorainecc.edu. All right, that's our domain. So you think of that as sort of like the address of the home page. That says what web server you're looking for when you're making requests. Remember back when we discussed, when we had our little diagram, we said about clients requesting web pages from a web server, and the way that clients know what web server to request is by the domain name. If I want Google, I'll type in google.com. Now, a domain name gets translated into an IP address. And an IP address are simply four, which I'm visualizing on, four three-digit numbers where the numbers can be 0 to 255. All right? So every website has a domain name, an IP address associated with it. But the thing is it's much easier for people to remember a name than a number like that. So therefore, the domain name is tied to an IP address, and it translates. There's something called a domain name server that translates your domain into the IP address. So I register a domain. So mycissus216.com, I go and register. All right. I purchase a server account. What that is there's space on a web server somewhere that has an IP address and has your domain name associated with it, and it gives you some space on that server. Now, all the details about your account varies depending on, like, the plan that you're on. All right? Do you know the details of the plan that you have?
No, not really, but I know I can host, like, a bunch of sites if I want to.
Yeah.
But I don't know, you know, like...
Right.
It's been a long time since...
Sure.
I still
sure.
have it, but I purchased it years ago.
Yeah, I don't know, like, the limitations of mine either.
Right.
You can actually host multiple sites with that. You can actually host subdomains. Like, for example, canvas.lorainecc.edu is a subdomain of lorainecc.edu. You have a certain amount of storage space, kilobytes or not kilobytes, geez, gigabytes or maybe megabytes. And sometimes there's restriction on the bandwidth. So, for example, you can only deliver a certain number of bytes. In other words, you could only handle a certain number of requests. The idea is you get what you pay for. If you only pay a little bit, then you might have some restrictions about how much you can upload or download. And then you upload files. You upload files. Uploading files would be similar to uploading an attachment to Canvas. You go and you find the file on your machine. You go and click the upload button, and it goes up to your space on the web, on the web server. Then it's available on the internet. Then it's available on the web. You're good to go. Now, this is an oversimplification. We'll talk about this more on Tuesday and maybe fill in some of the blanks and see a real example. But I think it's important to bring all this together because we've been developing web pages on our machines, but again, the power of the web is that anyone can access them, and therefore they need to be on a web server for that. So I think it's important. At least touch base on that. All right, we'll see you next week. We'll see you in lab or next week.